Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Emily Actrizandi, Managing Director of Atlantic Live. Thank you for joining us this afternoon to kick off the six years of the Atlantic's Women in Washington series. I would like to thank our underwriter for this program, ExxonMobil, and in particular, I'd like to welcome Terry Ferriello and thank her for her support. Terry is Vice President of Exxon's Washington office, and she has been a huge supporter of this program and made it possible. So Terry, thank you so much. We really appreciate your support. I'd also like to welcome those joining us via our live stream for this event. We are pleased to have you with us. And in a few moments, we will welcome, or actually she's on stage now, sorry, the Honorable Cecilia Muñoz, Assistant to the President and Director of the White House Domestic Policy Council. Before joining the Obama administration, Muñoz served as Senior Vice President for the Office of Research, Advocacy, and Legislation at the National Council of La Raza, the nation's largest Latino rights civil rights organization. And today's discussion will include powerful anecdotes from her personal and professional narratives, as well as insight into her time at the White House. And the Honorable Cecilia Muñoz will be interviewed by Atlantic contributor Margaret Carlson, who we're delighted to have joining us as well. So we encourage you to join us in the conversation on today's topics by following at @Atlantic_live and tweeting your thoughts on today's discussion using #AtlanticWow. And a few housekeeping notes. We'd ask that you please silence your cell phones. And we'll take questions from the audience a little bit later in the conversation. So please wait for a member of our team to come by with a microphone and identify yourself by sharing your name and affiliation before you ask your question. And now I'm going to turn things over to Margaret to get the interview started. And thank you again for joining us and look forward to this discussion. So thank you.
Thanks, Emily. So, Honorable Muñoz, your assistant Hannah, Press Secretary Hannah, wherever she is, gave me permission and said I should call you Cecilia.
Please do.
Okay,
oh my gosh.
So I'm not being flip. I'm just going to call her as she wishes to be called. So in your bio, it says you got a MacArthur grant. I've never met personally anyone who's gotten a genius grant, as they are called. And I've interviewed a lot of people who think they're geniuses, was on TV for 15 years with three men who thought they were geniuses. Can I just ask you, do they phone you?
They do.
And what time, early?
It's not like the Nobels. It doesn't come like in the middle of the night. But they do phone you out of the blue, and the thing is that you have no idea that you were being considered.
Because you don't apply to be a genius.
And you don't know that they're looking at you.
Yeah.
So I got a phone call, and actually I was at a conference in Miami, and like the people that I worked with knew I was at this conference, but like the rest of the world didn't know that I was at this conference. And the organizers of the conference walked in with a note for me and said, you have an urgent phone call, and it was a 312 number, which is a Chicago number. And my parents at the time were on a trip far away, and I immediately thought, okay, urgent message, clearly something's wrong. My parents are away, clearly there's been an accident. And I called the number and they answer MacArthur Foundation, and I thought, why is the MacArthur Foundation calling to tell me that my parents have been killed in a plane? And then they tell you, you know, that you're being awarded this incredible thing, and it changes your life. It's amazing.
This was doubly good news. No one died, and you're a genius, and you're going to have money. Wow,
yeah.
Wow. Those are the kinds of calls we'd all like to get.
It's an extraordinary, crazy thing.
Yeah. So you have, as I was trying to get ready for this, Cecilia has a mandate so broad. It made me think of that question when you asked it, how big are you? So big. It covers everything domestic. So it was hard to narrow it down to, you know, the things we could talk about. But how many of you have school-age children? So I decided I would start with education because I'm interested, even though my daughter's long out of school. She went to public school for many years. And there was news today in that Senator Mitch McConnell, for reasons I don't know, decided that he would move the bill to the floor, the Senate floor, amending the Education Act and fixing, perhaps, No Child Left Behind, the teaching to the test, some of the standards and whatever. So that happened today.
It passed with 81 votes.
81 votes.
Yep.
Now, did you get the pre-K?
Pre-K was offered as an amendment. It did not pass. But the fact of it being offered, the fact of the debate, and the fact that so many states are moving forward on pre-K is a great sign of progress. We're excited about it.
So what does it, let's see, the House bill was unacceptable
yes.
to you. The
yes.
Senate bill you could work with. What happens next?
Yeah, so the most important thing we still need to change about the Senate bill is accountability. We need to make sure that we are gathering data so that we know which students are making progress, which students are not making progress, and to make sure we arrive at a place where every student is getting the education that they need. So that is something the administration is still going to push for in this process. But we have a House bill which the president has threatened to veto because it does all kinds of things that we don't agree with, including moving money from poor districts to richer ones, which doesn't make sense. And a Senate bill, which has a lot of important stuff in it, which fixes the No Child Left Behind law, which still needs some work on accountability. But there will be a conference committee to negotiate between these two bills. I suspect we'll be actively involved in that process. And our hope is that we can reform this law in a way which makes sure that we build on the progress that we've been making. The good stuff which has been happening over the last 15 years includes the highest graduation rates in our country's history, including by subgroup, so that even the folks with lower graduation rates are actually making the most progress. And we know that because we've been measuring that data. But also get rid of some of the things where the pendulum had swung too far. So an amendment passed us yesterday, for example, which limits the amount of classroom time that can be spent on testing.
Wow, that's a big thing.
It's a big deal.
I have now two grandchildren in public schools here, and the teaching to the test is...
It's a problem.
And just the number of hours spent being tested is huge. So you're fixing that?
That's right. So clearly we can both gather the data we need to make sure that we know, that parents know, that schools know what's happening with every child, and can be addressing what's happening with every child, but not in such a way that we're taking the joy out of the classroom and spending all of our time on testing. That's the goal, and I think it's attainable. This has been, at least in the Senate, a strongly bipartisan process.
Amazing.
Yes,
one of the few things that you're getting the Congress to cooperate on.
Right, remember when they used to do that? It's a good thing.
I know, and Senator Lamar Alexander, who was Secretary of Education, stepped up.
He gets a lot of credit, as does Senator Murray. They work together on this.
Do you talk to him much?
Yes.
He seems like one of the ones that reaches across the aisle that the White House can talk to.
Senator Murray worked together on this bill, and they made a lot of progress, and we're hoping for more.
So let me ask you, are we catching up? I read the NAEP statistics. Are we catching up with Singapore and Finland?
Not yet, but we're moving in the right direction.
Yeah.
So the NAEP statistics actually show that we've made a tremendous progress in reading scores and math scores, and that, again, what's very important is that we're making progress not just in the aggregate, but also by subgroups, right? So it's not enough to say, as a general matter, we kind of score here as an average. It matters what girls are doing as well as boys. It matters how Latino students, how African American students, how Native American students are doing. So what we've been able to demonstrate is that we're making progress. But we actually just put out a report a couple weeks ago at the beginning of the Senate debate that shows the disparities still are unacceptably high.
Right. So you have 81%
graduating,
which is great, but at the lower income, that's so much harder.
That's all right.
Okay. The lower income, the disparity, it doesn't shrink the way the increases are going at the top. And when you said that this new bill shifts more money towards rich schools.
That's the House's approach. That's a mistake. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
But when you think about it, when I first came to Washington, which was 25 years ago now, what used to happen with respect to Latino students, which is the group I know the most, is that we were frequently not included in any accountability mechanisms at all. So even in the wonderful school system where my children went to school, the theory of the case was we're not sure these kids can perform, and so let's not include them in the accountability systems because we're not sure they can pass the tests, and therefore we'll concentrate on the kids that are. By including everybody in the accountability systems and by making sure we're collecting data on everybody and holding schools accountable for what happens, the change that I saw in my own school district was all of a sudden the PTA was talking about, gosh, how do we make sure that the English language learners in our school are successful, because we're all at stake with respect to these scores. So the result of that is that we went from a dropout rate, which was around 40% in the Latino community when I got here, to it's at 14 now. So that's, I mean, that's still too high, but that's a lot of progress. And we made that progress because, A, we collected the data, and we made sure that there was a reason for everybody to be together, to be responsible for what that data showed and for whether or not we actually closed the gaps. So, but the law, the No Child Left Behind law, ended up using a blunt instruments to accomplish right. that, and we can do better than blunt instruments. We need to make sure we make progress, we close disparities, but that we do it in a way that keeps the joy in the classroom and that supports teachers and makes sure that, you know, that everybody is successful.
So at the end, I'm going to ask you how you keep yourself going. I think you joined day one of the Obama administration.
I did. I started the day after the inauguration.
But I imagine it's those pieces of progress that do it, that you cling to. I have this wish, and it is that community colleges will kill for-profit colleges, that gyp veterans and the working class, and it's like payday lending. It's just so sad. So community colleges, mentoring, how is, I know that was part of universal pre-K and free community college. How are you going to do that?
So the president put forward a proposal that we figured out how to pay for to make 2 years of community college free. And the idea is that, you know, a century ago, most students didn't go to high school. High school wasn't free in the United States. So you stopped after like the sixth or seventh grade. And there was a whole social movement that was focused on making high school education free and accessible to everybody. And what that produced was the best trained workforce in the country, and that's how, as a nation, we led the world economically in the 20th century. And the rest of the world caught up with us. And what the president's point is, we have to do the same for higher education. At least 2 years of higher education should be as free and as accessible and as like understood as what everybody has to do as a high school education is today. And that's how we're going to lead the world economically in the 21st century the way we did in the 20th. So the president put forward this proposal. Congress is what it is, so we're not expecting it to happen, you know, in the next 18 months necessarily. But what we are seeing is progress in that. So Tennessee is already doing this. The city of Chicago is already doing this. Oregon is moving forward this week on a proposal for free community college, at least for some students. So we're beginning to see this debate taking root around the country, and that's how it happens, right? That's how the debate then makes its way to Washington. So we've among the exciting things about the president's proposal is that it really took off. Like, this was one that my daughters, who are young adults now, saw the announcement. That doesn't always happen. They don't read newspapers. They tend to get their news from other sources. Well, they're getting some of their news off of Facebook, for example. But this one they saw, and they both said, "Wow, this is great. Did you have something to do with this, Mom?"
Oh.
So that's, to me, that's success.
Right. So you're not embarrassing.
No. Well, at least not that day. But it caught on. People understand what he's talking about, that some level of secondary education is vital to not just the success of those students, but to our collective economic success. And it should be free.
So did Jill Biden get in on this at all, since she teaches?
Yes. So Dr. Biden has been a very much a leader in this effort. And we've been supporting community college since the beginning, very much with her guidance and inspiration. You know, she teaches at community college.
Everything. And she's like you. How do you do it?
Well, she is a very inspiring person, and she does it quietly. And I think many of her students don't realize that she's the second lady of the United States. But this is her life. This is what she does. And she does it quietly and with great grace. And she's a huge inspiration to our efforts. And community colleges are an enormously important part of the higher education sector. We're really proud that we've been so supportive.
For those for-profits to just go down.
Well, so I'm glad that you say that, because this administration is actually for the first time regulating the for-profit sector.
Well,
here's what happened. They sued us, right? So we put forward a rule that says to the for-profit sector, we're going to hold you accountable for your results for the extent to which that students can repay their loans, for example, and get gainfully employed. And we put forward three measures. They sued us. We lost on one of the three measures, so we re-regulated. They sued us again, and we just won twice in the courts so far in two district courts. So,
are they appealing, or
probably,
have you done it?
Well, I think they'll probably still appeal, but here's the thing. We're very confident that this standard that we've put forward, they're going to have to meet. And as a result, some of those schools have closed some of their campuses and some of their programs, and others have upped their game.
Oh, because I think the huge one, Corinthian,
that's right.
went out of business.
Under. That's right. They went under. But
and
some
blamed,
other schools...
And blamed you.
Yes, that's right. But look, you should be able to demonstrate that your students can at least pay off the loans that they took in order to get the education that you're providing.
Right. And maybe get a job.
And get, well, exactly. Yeah, that's right. The indicator for getting a job that actually can pay a decent salary. So, it's tremendously important, and we're making progress. In some cases, some of the for-profit colleges upped their game by basically saying, we're going to give you a trial period. Why don't you take the class and see if you think you can do it first before we accept any payment for you from you. So that means that the students who drop out of the program, take loans and then drop out right away, are not as exposed. So the industry has begun to change, and we think we're going to be able to have an impact on the worst actors.
Good. Before we leave education or mentoring, my brother's keeper. The president is very, very immersed in that and wants it to happen. How are you going to bring that about? It's such
it's
a challenge.
Happening. Yeah. So my brother's keeper has multiple parts. There's the part that the federal government is doing, and that's what we do with our education programs and our job training and other elements, which are focused on these sort of touch points in the lives of young men and boys of color, where we can have some impact, like being able to read on grade level by the third grade, for example. So there's a what the federal government is doing piece. There is an outside entity that has come together with a bunch of philanthropists that are have put in several hundred million dollars to support similar work in the that's happening outside of government. And then there's the My Brother's Keeper Community Challenge, where we have said to mayors and local leaders, you take this on too. And again, hundreds of communities have stepped up and said and have accepted the challenge, which means they have to do a convening, they have to come up with an action plan, they look at the same indicators that we identified of places where you can really have an impact on these lives and develop an action plan for the ones that they have chosen to influence. And so we didn't just start a conversation, we're seeing investment and we're seeing specificity of plans all around the country.
I've seen so many of these mentorings fail just because, you know, your heart's in the right place, but
yeah.
You need some amount of pressure and an ease of doing it to keep it going.
Well, and you need commitment over the long term, which is why we're insisting that for folks to be part of this effort, you can't just run a program. You have to set goals and have metrics. You have to measure whether or not you're getting to your goals. And that's tremendously important because, among other things, if you get that kind of feedback when you're running, whether it's a mentoring project or something else, that's what keeps you going. That's what helps you inspire the people who are volunteering or the other people that you're engaging, is that you can show, you know what, we accomplished this. That these are the kinds of results that we're seeing. Here's what's happening to the literacy rates. Here's what's happening to the number of students who are reading at grade level. Here's what's happening with respect to people getting to college successfully and finishing successfully.
I could stay on education the whole time, but I'm going to move on. Here's my Orange is the New Black question for you. I think you've organized, I want to move on to criminal justice, some trips to prisons for the president.
Today, he's at... Today, he's at a correctional facility, a federal facility in Oklahoma.
And what's he looking for doing? I know that he wants to release low-level drug offenders.
Yeah. He's done several things. So one is that he's announced a number of commutations of people who were low-level drug offenders, some of them who were sentenced to life, or who, if they had been sentenced under current sentencing policies, they would have already served their time. So he's commuted the sentences of dozens of people. But at the same time, he's very focused on criminal justice reform at both what we call the front end and the back end. So the front end is sentencing policies to make sure that they actually fit with the crimes. Right now, we sentence low-level drug offenders at rates that are much too high, and the prison population is huge and booming. We spend $80 billion a year. For that, we could provide pre-K to every four-year-old in this country. Or we could pay the tuition at every public university. So sentencing reform is kind of the front piece.
And you've gotten
piece.
Republicans on board.
Democrats
some
and Republicans,
Republicans
working together on
that.
That.
Yes.
And then reentry policies are the other end of the spectrum. And there is also bipartisan proposals in both the House and the Senate to make sure that we're doing an effective job of providing education and job training and services to help people when they leave prison become successful. Because the worst thing you can do is not prepare folks for life on the outside and they end up back in prison. It's obviously not good for them. It's not good for us either. I mean, we're losing tremendous talent and capacity in our workforce. The President's Council of Economic Advisors issued a report just this week which shows how much we lose as a result of the incarceration rates and the educational disparities.
And when you compare it to other countries, it's what we waste.
Well, and we lock up more people than the 35 top other economic countries combined.
Right, yeah.
Which is crazy and expensive and not fruitful, not useful. So we're hoping to reform the criminal justice system. And what the president is doing today with his visit is he's visiting with inmates. He's visiting with correctional officers. He's looking at some of the reentry programs in this facility and what some of what they're wrestling with to prepare people to leave. He's actually taping a documentary that will show in the fall. But he's also lifting up the issue. He's demonstrating, he's the first sitting president ever to visit a federal prison. And this is an opportunity to really lift up what this means. This isn't just a problem that affects somebody else. We're losing tremendous talent. We're spending appalling amounts of money and not getting results for it. And that doesn't make sense. So he's hopeful that this is an area where we'll see bipartisan reforms because we badly need them. They're overdue.
So we might have to move a little faster now if we're going to get to your questions, which I hope you're thinking up because there's so many things I won't get to. I want to ask you about the police and, you know, the spate of unarmed blacks being killed. One of the reports out of Charleston was that when Dylan Roof was arrested peaceably, no force, even though he had weapons. The arresting officers treated him to a meal. The judge asked after his family and how they were holding up, and he was treated very differently from some of the arrests of unarmed blacks, I think are injured and killed at three times the rate of other arrestees. From, what is it, Tamil Rice, the 12-year-old in Ohio with a BB gun, to Walter Scott. And then on Friday, a woman in Texas, her taillight wasn't on, or her turning signal wasn't on. She was thrown into prison because she talked back to the officer, apparently, we don't know. Because a lot of these need the video cameras, which I hope we're getting everywhere. I'm so in favor of those. But then she died in prison this week. So it's such an unfairness, and we get all excited about it.
Yeah.
And then the outrage dies down. The videos have helped somewhat.
Yeah.
Even the president said he's gotten outraged and then moves on. But in Charleston, you know, it's interesting. I don't know how many reporters are here. I know Jay Newton Small is, but you know, reporters never like to be moved by anything because we're cynical and hard-hearted, as you probably know. But it was something to watch people holding back their sniffling during the speech in Charleston. By the way, do you know, did he plan to sing Amazing Grace?
He thought about it. He told the First Lady and Valerie, I guess, in the helicopter on the way over, he kind of braced them. Yeah. He said, I'm thinking about singing. I'm going to see how it feels.
You know, and the fact that it was off-key made it all the better.
Kind of did, I know. He ended up in the key of E flat by the end, which is a good one.
It was quite something. With the one on Monday, it just doesn't end.
Well, that's exactly it. It feels like we're in this moment where, I mean, it's not like the abuse of people at the hands of police. And I should say that, saying that we and the president also have great admiration for what the police do every day, and it's tremendously important that we support them in doing this job well because they're so important. But it also feels like this is a thing which is not new. And frankly, the communities of color have been telling us that for a long time. But it feels like a veil is being lifted from something which has been real for a long time, but that kind of the rest of the country is starting to see, in part because it's been captured on tape so many times recently, so that it becomes undeniable. Just the way it was undeniable that racial hatred was what happened in Charleston because the shooter said it and left someone alive to tell it.
So it
was undeniable why it happened. And it's forcing us to reckon with something that, that we don't, the rest of the country doesn't always see, but which the African American community, the Latino community, other communities feel and deal with sometimes every day. It leaves us with a challenge of what we do about it. One of the things that we did with respect to policing was the president pulled together a task force on what we call 21st century policing, but he was very specific, so it was my office's job to pull this together. And he basically said, look, this is not just about assigning a commission to look at this. I want them to be finished in 90 days, and I want what they do to be actionable, and I want to make sure you have not just you have police officers, you have experts, I want community people, I want young people on this task force as well. And I want them to come up with their recommendations together. So that's what we did, and we pulled together a group that included organizers who had been protesting the police, as well as leaders from police forces and academic experts. And it's one set of recommendations, and those are unanimous recommendations. And they're actionable. This isn't an esoteric exercise. It is a listing of things that if you are a community leader who is worried about or upset about what's happening in your community, it's a set of tools that you can then take to your mayor, to your police chief, to your city council and say, what are you doing about recommendation 7.2? Like this is
one more video cameras and taking away that military equipment?
Yes, in fact, so we did that too. So the results of the policing task force are a blueprint for what can happen in order to make sure that police are guardians as opposed to feeling like military. Those are very different mindsets. And so it's a very actionable set of recommendations. And we're working with police forces around the country to implement them. And then we also pulled together, we took a look at the various statutes that allow or require the federal government to turn over military-style equipment to local police forces and are constraining that. There's now some kinds of equipment that used to be turned over that are prohibited now as a result of this administration's work. And for the kinds of things which are appropriate under some circumstances, police forces now have to ask for them, explain what they need them for, explain what the training is and what the protections are, and what the community involvement has been in the decision to request an armored vehicle or whatever it is. So we've changed those procedures to make sure, one, that police get the equipment that they need. Some of the equipment that's transferred, for example, is bulletproof vests. But also that we are bridging the divide between communities and their police, because at the end of the day, you can't keep a community safe if you're not integrated in the community and part of the community. And community policing is a hugely important tool, and we know a lot about it and how to make it work. And for that matter, the policing grants that the federal government gives are now tied to the recommendations of this policing task force, so that if you want money from the federal government, you have to show that you're doing what you should be.
So let me move on to immigration, which I think is part of why you're a genius. I think the grant came while you were at La Raza, is that right?
Yeah.
You gave a speech to a group of immigration lawyers, some of whom disinvited you.
Yeah.
Because they did not like what the administration was doing, even though the president issued an executive order because Congress wasn't doing enough or anything. And they call him the Emperor Obama for issuing this order. So, Empress Munoz,
I wish.
What have you done and why were they mad at you?
Well, so the people were mad at me. There were five or six people standing in the front holding signs on an issue, which is a really hard issue, which is detention of women and children coming from the migration that happened last summer from Central America. It's a hard, hard issue, and it's entirely reasonable to be asking questions about our detention policies and our enforcement policies. The big challenge with immigration reform is actually not a policy challenge. We know what will fix the immigration system, and there's bipartisan support around what will fix our immigration system. And the Senate passed a bill 2 years ago now with a strong bipartisan vote, which addresses that. Our problem is that the House wouldn't bring up that bill or anything similar because they have a political problem on the right in the Republican Party. So our what's keeping us from immigration reform is not a lack of ideas or policy solutions. Anybody who is engaged in this debate knows what needs to happen, and there's pretty much a consensus around it. It's a political problem, and that's the thing that we need to overcome to get to a place where our immigration system works. And in the meantime, we are stuck with one that's broken.
Well, you've lost the senators who are running for president.
Well, not Lindsey Graham.
Good. Rubio and I think
Senator Rubio. Senator Rubio was one of the gang of eight that developed the Senate bill, and he no longer supports his work.
And Governor Scott Walker.
Yeah.
Right. His own work. Yes.
Yeah.
God, who did that?
Yeah. But look, at the end of the day, we know what the solutions are, and the country supports them, and actually the majority of the U.S. Congress supports them. And if we could get them for a vote, we could have a system which is fixed. But it's going to continue to be a vexing problem as long as it gets used in the political way that it's being used. And it's ultimately a very bad thing for the country.
So where do the Dreamers stand? That seems to be something everybody is for. You come here because your parents brought you here as a child. And through no fault of your own, yep, if there's fault to be had, you still live in the shadows. So where did the executive order take care of the Dreamers?
Well, so the president took action in 2012 for the Dreamers for a particular group of them. They had to be under a particular age and have been in the country by a particular time. But almost 700,000 have come forward and received something called deferred action, which essentially means, yeah, you're undocumented and we know you're here, but we're deferring action on your deportation because we know that you're a low priority for removal. We have folks that are much more important to deport than you.
Donald Trump's rapists and criminals, yes, right.
And we'll give you the ability to work because we know you're not going anywhere. So you can get a Social Security number, you can work legally. And you have to renew that every 2 years. So that's what's available to Dreamers who meet those criteria. The president proposed expanding that program as well as creating a new program for people who have U.S. citizen children, people who are undocumented who have U.S. citizen children or children who are legal permanent residents. Mm-hmm. And those executive actions have been stopped so far in court, and we're fighting to be able to implement them.
So can you do more before you're gone on this?
Well, so the president announced a bunch of executive actions last November. The two that I just described are stuck so far in litigation. But there are others that we did, in fact, announce yesterday the results of a visa modernization task force, which across the federal government we looked at how we can improve and streamline the systems in our legal immigration process. So what the president asked us to do and what we're doing is everything that we can within the bounds of the law to fix what's broken. But the fact of the matter is the reason legal immigration is so backlogged is because there are categories defined by Congress and numbers of visas for those categories defined by Congress. And that we can't change that through executive fiat. Congress needs to act and do its job. And one of the interesting things about that is that I get to work with all of these really smart economists in the President's Council of Economic Advisors. And what they've found is that if you're focused on, as we have been since the very beginning, economic growth and what's going to create jobs and stimulate the economy, one of the things you look at is our workforce and our capacity to grow our workforce, because it turns out we're getting older and we have an aging workforce.
Oh, we are.
It turns out.
Yeah.
And immigration is actually one of the best tools we have for economic growth, and we are missing an opportunity.
Before I ask you a couple of questions about your life, before I turn it over, overtime, quickly. Yeah. The idea that people should be paid for the hours they work, shocking.
Right.
And it's going to ruin the economy because nobody will hire anybody. Tell me about the overtime.
We haven't updated our overtime laws meaningfully since the 1970s. So right now the threshold is just under $23,000. So you can be making $24,000 and your boss can say, oh, you're a manager because I'm going to ask you to spend 5 minutes making the schedule. and now I need you to work 70 hours a week for that $24,000, and you're not eligible for overtime. So what we did was the president asked the Department of Labor to look at that salary threshold, and they've just proposed to raise it to around $50,000. About 5 million people will be affected by that, and one of two things is going to happen. They'll either get paid for those overtime, for those extra 30 hours of work, or they'll earn $24,000 and only be expected to work 40 hours a week, and they'll get to see their kids. Both of those are good outcomes, and it was high time we updated that policy.
You know, one of the huge problems you read about is this shift work where people work, I think, much harder than anybody in this room, where they have three or four jobs, they're racing around, they don't sleep regular hours because, you know, they don't know whether their Starbucks, you know, hours are going to be in the morning or the night. It's just an appalling way to live and live at the margins. Are you going to do anything about that?
So, in fact, we are in conversations with folks in the business community as well as workers on scheduling policy, which is what you're describing, mm-hmm. To figure out what the solutions are. Some of them are technological solutions, but what's really clear is that, in fact, we met with a bunch of companies who are doing this well, who have kind of built this into the mindset of the companies, and what they figured out is, lo and behold, they want their workers to like their jobs, and they want to keep their workers. They don't want high turnover rates, and they want to run companies with the sort of spirit of, we're a team, and when my coworker has a death in the family, I want to cover for them because I want to create the space for them to have their life and make sure that when I need to go to my kid's recital, I can do that too. So there are companies who have figured this out, and we're trying to make that more of the norm. Mm-hmm. Because we're squeezing too much out of people in a way that is not just harmful to them, it's harmful to us, it's harmful to our economy, it's harmful to kind of who we are as a nation. We can do better.
So let me ask you a little bit about how you got where you are, but a little bit more, how do you do as much as you do? How, you know, I just read a book about tidying up, and I realized I was a hoarder. And I read a book about organization, and I realize I have none. I just do things as they come along and hit me. Like, I can't unload the dishwasher and write a column in the same day. So you do have the broadest mandate of anyone in the White House. There was a book called How Does She Do It? So what can you tell us? Not that any of you need any help.
I work with a lot of really smart people, so I'll start there. The team that there's about
40. We have Hannah here.
Hannah's one of them, and Hannah will vouch that the team that we work with is the most incredible group of people I've ever known. I mean, really extraordinary, brilliant people. So part of my job as a leader of the Domestic Policy Council is to help them do their jobs well and kind of do the blocking and tackling that they need in order to be able to drive healthcare policy or education policy or whatever else they do. So you know, you put yourself in the service of the people who know more than you do, and you can do pretty well. But the president is also very exacting about making sure we have clear priorities and that we prioritize the things which are going to be the most impactful. I mean, he ran for this office for a reason, and he really expects of himself to make every minute count, and that's what he expects of his team as well. So that's a pretty tall order. It's important.
And going back to, you've been there since the beginning, how do you get up every day with enough enthusiasm to keep at it?
So the enthusiasm isn't hard because, I mean, I get to work on education and immigration and civil rights and criminal justice and policing. I mean, these are all the important issues of our time.
And I skipped over Native Americans. And I'm so sorry, but we are going to be running out of time, and they will be unhappy.
And we can
they
spend a whole hour on
we
that.
We could. I know we could.
So the enthusiasm isn't hard. It's amazing to be able to work on these issues with this team every day.
So what are you watching, if anything? Any movies?
Do you mean on television?
Any TV, any movies? Neither.
So the advice I got from the very wonderful John Podesta, who was who was on our team for a while and was the chief of staff in the Clinton administration, was, because my two daughters were still at home then, and I was very worried about not seeing them. And he said, well, you can see your family and have a job like this, but you have to accept that you jettison everything else. Like, you get one thing besides work, and if that thing is your family, then that's it. Mm. No TV, no sporting events. I used to sing in a choir. I can't do that. Oh. He was right about that, but it's worth it.
And so your daughters now think you're cool.
Mostly, sometimes.
Yeah. And they're in college now?
One graduated a year ago, and the other will be a junior in the fall.
Can you picture life after the White House? People
Not
who
really.
Leave it say, you know, you never get used to a pace outside of the White House.
Yeah, I can imagine that. It is, I have no earthly idea what I'll do next. I was at the National Consulata Rasa for 20 years before I came into government. It is a hard thing to picture. I like the idea of maybe having shorter hours. That seems, that would be nice.
Do you ever get to the grocery store, for instance?
Occasionally on Sundays, but I have to tell you, I am married to a saint, so the reason I don't make it to the grocery store is because he does.
Yeah, I would miss the grocery store. It's the one domestic task I actually like. I'm like somebody from the Soviet Union. I'm just amazed. There are 100 salad dressings at the grocery store.
I occasionally make it to the farmer's market, actually.
Oh, that's good. So let me move on to our audience and ask for your questions. Yes. Is there a mic? We'll go here, and then we'll go to my former colleague, J. Newton Small from Time Magazine.
Thank you for having me here. My name is Daniela Kamrath. I'm the executive director of Alianza Foundation, and I've been in your country for 6 weeks. And it's an honor to meet you. I've been working with women in Romania, where I come from, for 15 years, and I want to ask you, in this very testosterone-dominated job you have, what are the qualities, the virtues that you believe made you be who you are at your workplace and succeed in what you're doing and also keeping all together with your family and home?
Thank you. What a lovely question, and welcome.
Thank you.
So I think a lot about women in leadership, and I'm proud to say that there are more White House offices being led by women than by men at the moment in the administration. But the thing that really the men and the women who have been most successful where I work, the quality that we share is that none of us are actually in this for ourselves. This is not about our careers. You can spot people in this town, and there are people in this town who are doing good work for the world, but also have one eye on how does this lift me up and how does this position me for whatever. The people I admire the most, and there are a lot of them in the administration, are the people who don't ever really think about that. That if you focus on the work that's good for the world, that's good for the country, the rest follows. But if you're focused on positioning yourself, it shows, and it means you're not, that's a different priority than what matters the most. And when you work for a president who is oriented that way, it's pretty easy to find support for that kind of orientation. And it really affects the quality of our work, and it affects the quality of our team. We are deeply invested in each other's success, because if my counterpart who runs the National Economic Council is successful, that means the country does better. And so, of course, not only am I not competing, but we're invested in each other's success because the whole enterprise is important.
Let me just footnote that with, there's a pay disparity in the White House between the women and the men. I think it's something like 16 or 17%. I don't know if that figure is right, but is there one?
It's 9 cents. But it's not, so here's how it works. We have equal pay for equal work at the White House, which you can look up because we also have transparency. Both of those things are important as a policy matter. Meaning, Jeff Zients, who runs the National Economic Council, has the equivalent job title to mine, and we make exactly the same salary, and you can look it up. So we have equal pay for equal work, and we have transparency. The reason for the difference, if you add up what all the women make and what all the men make, you find that there's a 9 cent disparity. And that's because it's no longer because there are more men in the highest paid positions, because in fact there are more women in the highest paid positions than there are men right now, but we also have more women in the lowest paid positions. And so that's what accounts for the disparity. So the policy solution to that is promoting people. And in fact, I thought about this, because I thought this question might come up. I go around the table, we have this early morning meeting with all the senior staff. except for Valerie Jarrett, who started as a senior advisor to the president, which is the highest level position other than the president and the vice president themselves, every single woman in that room has been promoted, including me. And so that's been a very deliberate effort, and that's how that disparity has shrunk.
Good. Glad to hear it. Jay. We'll get to Jay next.
Hi, Abigail Golden Vasquez. I'm the director of the Latinos in Society program at the Aspen Institute. Hi, Cecilia. Nice to see you. I wanted to ask about what we can do about the disparities of Latino participation in civil service, in public service. There's been some progress, but it's still way out of line with the numbers.
This is a great question. So if you look at both political appointments as well as people in the civil service working as public servants in the government, the Latino numbers are just way low in general. That's been historically true. And it's a combination of factors. It turns out to be a very difficult nut to crack. And my colleagues at the Office of Personnel Management work on this day in and day out and are working very deliberately to make sure that we address those disparities. And it has to do with all kinds of things. It has to do with examples of people in public service. It has to do with deliberate recruiting efforts for people coming out of school, as well as people who were mid-career. It turns out that it's not enough to just say we're kind of open to all kinds of different kinds of people. You really have to be deliberate and even aggressive. So we've done things like get the entire Hispanic caucus to nominate schools that have high proportions of Latinos graduating, and we've gone and actually, I think of it as tackling entire groups of students and brought them to Washington and helped them meet people who are in these kinds of jobs. I mean, we're really aggressively trying to recruit students who are people with disabilities, because that's another area that's underrepresented, as well as Latinos who are underrepresented, and create pathways into these jobs that can then lead to greater rates of hiring. So you need, it's a both a recruitment effort, and then it needs to be something that we're aggressive about with at all of the federal agencies. Again, it's not enough to say, well, of course we're open to all comers. If you actually look in all of the hiring decisions are people who look and sound and act like each other.
There's a New Yorker cartoon this week that shows that there are people who are aggressive in the other direction. It's a scene in Silicon Valley with the foosball table and the beanbag chair and all of that. And they're sitting around and saying, let's go public before we have to hire our first woman. So there are pockets where
you have to be deliberate. You have to set goals and measure against them and be aggressive in meeting them.
Yeah. Jay, could you stand up?
I actually wanted to ask about immigration and the court challenges. Do you expect the Supreme Court to hear some of these challenges perhaps next summer? And do you hope for that? And what do you think will happen there?
Well, we're not at that stage yet. So right now, this is the executive actions that have been stopped in the courts. We're in the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. They just held their hearing on this on Friday. So we have to wait for them to decide. And I think it's probably a pretty safe assumption that whoever loses when they decide is likely to appeal. Then this court has to decide to take the case. So all of those things are still unknowns. The thing that I do know is that we did our homework before the president announced these executive actions. We are very comfortable that they're within the bounds of his authority under the law, extremely comfortable. So we know we're right, and we know we're on the right side of history. And this administration is going to continue to fight in order to implement these because they're tremendously important. But at the end of the day, what the executive actions do, and this has been the president's point for years, for people who have been pressing him to take this kind of action, he does not have the authority to permanently fix what's broken about our immigration system. For that, Congress needs to do its job. So we will fight to be able to implement the executive actions, but at the end of the day, the permanent solution that we need to our broken immigration system requires action by the Congress, and we have to keep our eye on that ball as well.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm Lori Fitzpagato. I'm at the Livingston Group in my day job, but I do a lot of volunteer work with the Latino community. I wanted to get some clarification. I heard what you just said, but on DACA, for the 700,000 who have already qualified,
And
that have to reapply every 2 years?
Yep.
What is the risk there?
So So these are folks who I described the deferred action process, and there's a 2-year renewal process. So they come forward, and as long as they continue to be qualified, which essentially means they haven't broken the law, then their deferred action and their work authorization will be renewed for another 2 years. A future administration is going to have to decide whether or not they continue to do that. I think, and the president has said, it's going to be very difficult for some future president to say, well, now that we know who all of you are, we're actually going to remove you from the country. But presumably some future administration could decide not to renew. And it's going to be an important question for people to ask the folks who are asking for votes in their communities, it seems to me.
We have time for another couple questions. In the back there.
Hello, Amy Glover with McLarty Associates. I was wondering if you could offer some creative ideas on how the government can help encourage the empowerment of women and the advancement of women in business. Because while we see more and more women in the higher echelons of government, it's still pretty dismal in the private sector.
Yeah, this is a great question. I have a wonderful colleague from the Council of Economic Advisors named Betsy Stevenson, she's an economist, formerly from the University of Michigan, actually, which is my alma mater. And she's been talking to folks in business schools on this very question to make sure that this is kind of part of the training and part of the goal setting and the kind of the DNA of folks who are getting training for careers in the corporate and business worlds. We've learned a lot about diversity of leadership and what that contributes to our economic success. So diversity turns out not to be just a thing that we do because we're good people, but rather a thing that we also do because it turns out to be great for the bottom line to have leadership and participation from people with all kinds of different kinds of perspectives. And so part of Betsy is leading a conversation with business schools, for example, to make that part of the equation and to show best practices and highlight ways that this can be kind of built into people's training from the outset to help kind of bring that into the corporate world.
Up front here. Here, do you want my mic for a sec? Here. For speed.
Thank you. My name is Marcy Cohen, and I'm a zoning commissioner here in DC. And my question is, a lot of local governments are really struggling with the disparity in income and access to housing. And I was wondering, what are some of the steps the federal government is taking to address that issue?
Income or access to housing, or both?
Both.
So, I mean, in some ways, this is the challenge of our time, right, is that we recognize that for all the progress that we're making economically, we need to make sure we're making progress with respect to wages for people at the bottom. So this is what the overtime policy is about. It's what the minimum wage policy conversation that we're having is about. And it's what, you know, there's a lot of organizing around the minimum wage and a lot of activity happening around the country that we're excited about, although we still need to address it at a federal level. With respect to housing, it's also tremendously important because home ownership in particular is how folks amass wealth. And for most regular folks, it's the only way that you amass wealth. So that's, again, about making sure people have access to capital. It's about making sure that we make that possible with respect to home ownership, but that we're also engaged in making sure that there's affordable housing available for people who are renters. So that's actually a tremendously important part of the conversation that we have about the availability of housing, where we make investments, and HUD is doing actually some very important work in making sure that the resources that the federal government brings to this equation are aimed at creating opportunity. So they just put forward a rule a couple of weeks ago. It's called the Affirmatively Furthering Fair Housing Rule, but the bottom line of what that produces is that it gives you and everybody else access to the data that shows where is there segregation, where are there communities that don't have access to transportation to help people to get to jobs, and any community that's accepting HUD dollars needs to have a plan for how they're going to use those dollars to further fair housing. And they're going to have access to this data so that they can actually kind of plug in the information about where are the neighborhoods of need and what are the specifics of what they need, so that a community that with leadership that wants to do the right thing has the tools to do it, but that advocates and regular folks in the community who want to encourage their leadership to do the right thing also have the same set of tools and the same information. So commentators on that rule have observed that this was actually built into the law that passed in the late 60s, but has never been implemented until now. And so this is a really, it's actually an exciting new set of tools that we'll be able to all collectively use to really focus on this question of making opportunity really available, neighborhood by neighborhood, block by block.
So Cecilia, we're out of time, but I'm going to award myself the last question. A very big one, but we only have a minute. How has the president changed over the last, is it 7 years now, since you've been up close and personal all this time?
His hair is a little grayer.
Oh, it is. So is mine, but
yeah.
You wouldn't know.
Yeah, me, yeah. You and me,
yeah.
Both.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think he's changed. I think he's feeling a little more liberated because he doesn't have to run for anything ever again. But what...
He was very liberated yesterday in the press conference on the Iran deal.
He was, but I tell you what, he shows that level of passion on a lot of stuff. And what he's asking his team to do today and what he asked us to do when we first got here is not so different. I mean, this is the same guy who had the courage to stick with the Affordable Care Act when the whole town thought it was dead over and over and over again, and the results of that are pretty impressive. That took enthusiasm and engagement and the same passionate commitment.
So he doesn't get
yesterday.
Discouraged.
No, he doesn't. No. This is a guy who plays the long game, and we have the Affordable Care Act, and we have the ability for anyone in this country to get married, and a whole host of other achievements to be grateful for as a result.
Well, since I'm a columnist, I get to say congratulations to you for what you do, since I don't have to be unbiased. And I thank you for coming here today. It's been wonderful.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you again to Cecilia Muñoz, and thank you, Margaret Carlson, for what was a great discussion. And I again want to thank Terry Ferriello and ExxonMobil for their ongoing support of our Women in Washington series. Be on the lookout. We have two more of these programs coming up in the months ahead. So we'll send you all information, and I hope everyone enjoys their day. Thank you.